Today we're going to learn how to make a castle tower. I'm making mine out of brick to go with my castle gate, but it is a beautiful piece of terrain that will stand on its own just fine. I just wanted something to accompany mine to make it stand out a little bit more. So, I'm going to show you the bricklaying techniques, how to make the bricks, and how to make the wood for the top. So first things first, we need a base for this to stand on. You wouldn't need a base for this to stand up, but you need a place to lay the bricks, which you're going to need an absolute ton of. But let's move those out of the way for now and begin cutting the base out of just a normal piece of cardboard. It'll do for our purposes here. It's really just for laying out those bricks on it, so don't waste your time on buying anything good. Now, I have these bricks left over from a previous project, but I can show you how to make them. They are 3/8 of an inch by 3/4 of an inch, and then that 3/8 of an inch is the square size. So it's really easy to do. You can definitely do this with a knife. I've just got the Proxon cutter, so I'm going to go ahead and use that to make things a lot faster. I'm going to cut out a bunch of 3-inch wide sections of foam because 3/4 of an inch times 4, it should yield 4 bricks wide. So cutting those out and then making them 3/4 of an inch thick. And then I'm going to cut out the next bit, which will be the 3/8 of an inch tall pieces of brick. Now, since it is 3/4 of an inch thick, we need that 3/8 of an inch for one side, and then we're cutting out another 3/8 of an inch off of all of the strips that we're making. So this is how you make a bunch of bricks really, really quickly, and there's no hassle to it. I don't bother cutting them out like I did last time. It's just one and done, and then we're going to texture them in a bit. But this will get you a ton of bricks really quickly, and I did not have near the amount of bricks I needed for this project, so making them was a good thing. But they'll kind of stick together as you do them, and if they do, not a big deal. It'll just take a few minutes and just pop them all off. That way you've got your individual bricks, which will be used for the next section, because like I said, we need a ton of individual bricks because we're basically building this thing from the ground up as if we were stonemasons ourselves. So take your pile of foam bricks and we're going to put them in a Ziploc baggie. We don't need to be fancy about this. The easier it is and more malleable the packaging is, the better results you're going to get from this. So rather than going through and individually texturing them all with a piece of foil or stone or something like that, really, if you just put them in a bag and mash the crap out of them, it looks like I'm mashing it pretty softly, but really I'm putting a decent amount of force in it. The foam will kind of absorb most of the work that you're doing, so really smash them around and you'll get a nice stone texture on them. Now that we've got our texturized bricks, it's really down to laying a ton of bricks. This is a super tedious process, but it's worth it to get those kind of individual brick looks, in my opinion. And I was really trying to mimic the stone structure that I did of the city gate before, so having a bunch of individual bricks is what I did. I wanted to do it again. I use hot glue as the base for all of these. You can use regular PVA glue, that would work. It just takes a lot longer to dry, and this already will take you maybe an hour or two to set all the bricks just going non-stop. So I really didn't want to sit there, lay down a layer, wait maybe half an hour for it to dry, and then do it again. So the main reason I use hot glue is that it's quicker. The other stuff will probably work just as well. It's all structurally sound, like it's all glue, right? So it will work. Hot glue was just what I chose to do. So I would lay down a bead of hot glue, place down a brick, and it would be good to go. Now, one thing that you should notice here on the pattern is I laid down the bricks, but then I tried to overlap the edges of where the bricks below it were with a brick above so that it wasn't just like a single straight line going all the way up. You'll see it kind of zigzags back and forth, and that's kind of what they used to do because it made things a lot more structurally sound, and that's what I did here. It just kind of worked, and it was similar to what I did before, and I wanted to kind of continue that process. And here I found some gaps, decided to fill it in with a little bit more hot glue, make it, you know, a little more structurally sound and be able to take the paint and just kind of build up. It takes a while, but man, it does show in the results that this is worth it. Now we're going to just skip ahead a little bit because you've seen me lay enough brick. We're going to make the crenellations, which is kind of the spots where the archers hide behind. And for that, we're going to make a couple of 3x4 inch solid square blocks. They're basically setting up four bricks, but I wanted them to be one solid piece. So they also need to sit on something flat, so we need to create these kind of weird diagonal pieces there, and that's difficult to do. You really just kind of have to eyeball it. So I made some 3/4 inch long strips that were same way we made the bricks, and I also made them 3/4 inch wide, but they were still 3/8 inch thick. So what I do here is just kind of take them at a diagonal, and the best way to do this is just to eyeball it. I'm sure there's jigs out there, but honestly, doing this almost textures it to give it kind of that stone look by itself. So you'll kind of see that as we go up. So I make a bunch of those by taking some diagonal cuts off of a 3/4 by 3/4 by 3/8 inch block section. So then we're going to glue them up, which is where we are going to put the crenellations on. Now, the combination of the 3/8 inch flat surface that we just made with the thickness of a 3/8 inch brick gives us that full 3/4 inch, which matches up perfectly with our square 3/4 inch blocks for the crenellation. So I do two sides with three on them, and then two sides with two. The ones with two are supposed to line up so that the castle gate that I have will fit snugly in there, and a ladder will be able to kind of go up in there, and it'll make it look a little bit more modular. So now, taking those 3/4 by 3/4 inch cubes, we're going to texture those up with a foil ball. It's tried and true. It really works to make that kind of stone texture. So go over every single one of those, because you really want this detail to shine, being that those are kind of the corner pieces of the tower. That's what catches the eye. So make sure you do that one really well. And then we're just going to start hot gluing them on there. So put a large dab of hot glue on there before we begin placing them. And then you're going to place them on the junction where the wall bricks connect to the diagonal pieces. That way it sits perfectly flat and you've got a very, very nice looking crenellation there. So keep gluing all of your crenellation pieces on top. And when you do, you're really kind of done with the main portion of the outside. Then we're going to need to start building the section which will hold up the wood planks, right, that we're going to use. And I make a mistake here. I think that this is enough by just gluing some excess pieces on there that it will hold up the wood, but it won't. And I'll show you that we fix that later, but it actually is a nice holder for a platform. Speaking of the wood that we will use on that platform, I like to mix up three separate shades of brown and not mix them too thoroughly. That way you might be able to see some of the different shades shine through, and it gives me the color that I want to use for kind of a oaky stained look on top of the castle tower. So I paint both sides, that way I can pick which side I like better, because, you know, there's always one side that turns out better and we can pick the good side, right? So I just make a ton of these because we're going to use them for multiple different things. So just paint up a ton of coffee stirrers. You can get them real cheap, don't worry about them. We will be using them as we move forward. Before we place the actual wood planks on the platform, we need to coat the whole thing in black paint and Mod Podge as a mixture. I did that in my Overgrown House video. You can take a look at the top, and that mixture idea I got from the Black Magic Craft YouTube page. So, doing this, after that dries, we're going to paint it in a really dark shade of gray. The dark shade is our base coat. It kind of picks up some of the black from underneath, which is really what we want. We don't need to paint the inside of this tower. You're not going to see it, so don't worry about painting all that pink on the inside. Just make sure that you cover any sort of pink that you might see on the outside or any of the plain black. Once you do that, you're good to go. Just use your darkest gray that you have, because we're going to put a lot of dry brushed on highlights later. So, as long as you're happy with how it looks, you really only need to do one coat. That's what I did. The first set of dry brushing that we're going to do is this kind of antique white. It's almost got kind of earthy brownness to it. It's almost a tan, right? And we want to be really liberal with this dry brush. The more kind of tan you show in stone, the more natural it looks. Going with too much gray, stone isn't just all gray, right? You got to have a little bit of brown in there. So really be heavy-handed on this one, getting all the nooks and crannies, and then we will kind of fix it up later as we do a little bit more gray dry brush at the final part. But for now, get your tan-ish antique white dry brush in as much as you can. Now we're going to start cutting the planks to length. So I basically eyeballed it at the beginning. It is very important that you get them all to length, but they can vary a little bit in size. So I take one, move it all the way across, find a length that works, and cool. That one will work as my guide for now. So take your clippers. I just use some crappy ones that I got in a cheap bin from Home Depot a long time ago. They still work fine. So I just cut off the coffee stirrers and kind of use that first one as a guide for my length. As long as everything's pretty darn close to that one, we should be good to go. So just make a ton of those, and you can see it will work as kind of a platform. So here is where I realized that, hey, the platform setup that I have currently isn't going to work. There's too many gaps in between this stone, and the wood will just kind of fall right through, and so it won't hold itself up properly, so we need to fix that. So I take a measurement on the inside, and it comes out to about 4 1/4, and I cut off a really thin piece of foam that will go all the way across, and I paint it gray and let it dry so that it works as a nice platform for the wood to lay on. I put some hot glue down and bada boom, now we have a completely flat surface for the wood to work on. We're going to swap from using hot glue over to PVA, which is just Elmer's school glue. It works perfect for this, goes on white, dries clear, and just start laying your pieces of wood down. It will stick to it just fine. You may need to hold it down after a bit and some squeeze up might happen. That's good. It's better to have more glue than none. None would be bad in this situation. So I hold it down with just a heavy candle and that works for me. So now we're going to use a black wash. It's the same one again that I used in the overgrown house video from before, and be extremely liberal with this. We really want it to come out as dark. The gray we have currently is nowhere near dark enough, and we have way too much of the kind of brown antique white. It's a good thing we want that, because we're accounting for this extremely dark wash to go over it. So be liberal and just let it sit. Make sure you put it on the oak planks because we want those to be dark too. But then we're going to dry brush with a lighter gray, and that is what really, that makes the stone just pop, doesn't it? Doing that light bit of gray all over, doing a lighter touch than you did before, boom, it looks almost identical to the other one, and we have our completed project. This is done. The details in the stonework alone make this worth it. You can see the little differences between the gray and the antique white and the dark wash that goes in there. I'm planning on using this for tons of my games in the future. If you like this, please consider subscribing or comment down below what you might want to see next time. I'd love to hear other people's ideas on what you might want me to try and do, because I don't always have a ton of ideas. So thanks for watching and hope to see you around.
Let me into the town or I'll be forced to break the gate down.
Stand back, lest we let our arrows fly.
Maybe you didn't see that I came with a pet hydra. Blow the damn door down.
You know what? On second thought, just come on in.